is our fiketorial concept. Their greatness and uniqueness lay in this, that they left the surface of the earth and decided to go into the cave for the sake of one Allah, whose unity they wanted to preserve. Despite the fact that, as earlier verses tell, the surface of the earth is blessed by Allah with charms, and they leave all those charms for the sake of Allah and go underneath, go underground, because they wanted to save their faith and their religion and their love of their Creator. They are the people for whose sake blessings would be shown to all those who adhere to Christianity. Whether they are right or wrong, that is insignificant. When Allah blesses the people, then He doesn't choose just the pious ones for showing blessings. For the sake of a few pious, the entire people are blessed. Later on, in the end, now this shows the religion of Dajjal, because Rasul Akram sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, to save yourself from the influence of the Dajjal, I don't remember exactly what is the word used, influence or from injury or what? But let's, in general terms, I'm not exactly translating the definition. But what, in essence, it says that if you want to be aware of the Dajjal and to know who he is and to save yourself from the injury, spiritual or otherwise, or to recognize him, all these things are conveyed in this. Then you should recite the first 10 and the last 10 verses of the Surah Taha. So the first 10 tell us that the Dajjal belongs to Christianity and the distorted form of Christianity. The Yunzirul Ladina Qalu Takhadallahu Walada. This is the nature of the Dajjal's religion. In the end, it has a reference to the great progress, great material progress of Christians. So to recognize them through another means, another indicator has been thrown. From religion, this finger points to Christianity. And in the end it says, أَفَحَسِبَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَنْ يَتَّخِذُوا عِبَادِي مِنْ دُونِي أَوْلِيَاءَ إِنَّا أَعْتَدْنَا جَهَنَّمَ لِلْكَافِرِينَ نُزُلًا.
إِنَّا عَاتَدْنَا جَهَنَّمَ لِلْكَافِرِينَ نُزُلًا قُلْ هَلْ نُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِالْأَخْسَرِينَ أَعْمَالًا الَّذِينَ ضَلَّ سَعْيُهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَهُمْ يَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّهُمْ يُحْسِنُونَ صُنْعًا. The first verse again refers to the same Christianity with which the opening verses of the Holy Quran introduced us. But here, it is not just one part of their calling out. There are myriads of saints they are calling besides us. So one deviating step ended into this utter destruction of faith. Previously, they called just one son as partner with Allah. And when Christianity deteriorated further, it was not just one son. There were thousands and thousands of saints. أَفَحَسِبَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَنْ يَتَّخِذُوا عِبَادِي مِنْ دُونِي أَوْلِيَاءَ. Not of them. Many, many servants of Allah are now being worshipped by Christians in the name of saints. But as far as their material progress is concerned, they have reached a stage where they believe that they are master of technology. Sunnah is technology. And Sunnah is also the end product of science. If technology was not to be the end product of science, people would leave interest in science. It is the material gain of science which is keeping the world interested in scientific studies, and it is the technology, high technology, which is actually the means of material gains, not science in itself. So nowadays a debate is raging between scientists and the technologists, and some third world countries say there is no need for science, spending so much money, while what actually you require is technology. So Allah does not mention science here. That is the beauty of the Holy Quran. It only mentions the end product in which the materialistic world would be interested. The technology, they say, we have developed so strongly and so beautifully that we have reached the height of excellence. Then Allah tells us that this will not be of any avail to them and they are going to be totally destroyed. So there are so many things to it. As I told you, in brief I'll explain its relationship to Dajjal. Both these aspects are of the same people, which is the Christian world or the Western world. They have highly developed technology and they have highly distorted religion. So one eye is bright and the other is blind. This is why Hazrat Akram sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the Dajjal has one eye blind, which is right, and the one eye blind, very prominent, and that is the left. This is exactly what the Holy Quran says. So when the Ahl-e Hadith try to persuade me that there is no validity of traditions, I tell them, you don't understand. Every tradition of Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam has its roots in the Holy Quran. So has this one-eyed Dajjal its roots in this Surah Al-Kahf. From the point of view of religion, this Surah Al-Kahf describes them to be totally blind. And from the point of view of technology and scientific achievements, they can see things which the other people are completely incapable of seeing. Now the lady, please. Well, Sam, you wanted to ask a question?
What should a woman do if she
finds herself? Now, this microphone and this system is not working. And I can hear directly your voice, but quite feeble.
What should a woman do?
Right. What should a woman do? That I know. Understand, yes.
What should a woman do if she is trapped in a marriage where she is unable to exercise her religion as she would like to?
She should do at least what the wife of Pharaoh did.
Thank you.
Yes, please. Yes.
قوله تعالى أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ولقد كتبنا في الزبور من بعد الذكر أن الأرض يرثها عبادي الصالحون فلو سمحتم سيدي نسمع شرحاً لهذا.
That's correct, but you can read this in detail in Tafsir Kabir by Hazrat Muslim Maud. He has commented on this verse in detail, and the time now is very short. In fact, it is over, and this verse requires a special treatment, and it will require about 40 to 45 minutes to explain it in detail. So this is not the right forum. But anyway, I understand you know it already. You must have read it in Tafsir-e Kabir. And because you are from Palestine, you want me to tell everybody what is going to happen to Palestine. Is that right?
Yes.
It will, inshallah, come under the sway of Ahmadiyyat one day. That is what it means. Yarithuha Ibadiyyat Salihun means, in reality, that the Ibadiyyat Salihun of that day will inherit it. Because at present it is in the hands of usurpers